Hello and welcome to the 16th gathering of the Adventure Party on this, the 18th of July. I am your party leader, Brad Ludwig. We ask that you peace tie your swords, holster your blasters, and make sure you know the difference between a shuggoth and a deep one while you're gathered at the meeting table. As always, the second in command here at the Adventure Party is Glenn Bittner. He is a movie reviewer on the YouTube show The B-Movie Bunker and is the creator of the RPG Mistrunner. How are you this fine evening, sir?
I am quite well, Brad. Thank you for asking.
you sound like you took a tranquilizer before the show, sir. You're all right?
Just fine.
Winding down from a long day, I bet.
Winding down. I'd leave here and go paint some happy trees.
There you go. Or some miniatures at least.
Yes.
Our guest today is game designer Kenneth Hite of Pelgrane Press. The Pelgrane Press publishes a number of RPGs, which include Owlhoot Trail, which I have played and enjoy the heck out of, 13th Age, Gumshoe, and much, much more. Kenneth has worked on created the game settings in Gumshoe for Trail of Cthulhu and Night's Black Agents. You know, the more in the course of getting things ready for a show, I went down the rabbit hole and I looked at all this stuff that you are a part of, sir, and it's fantastic, and I can't wait to talk to you about some of that. Kenneth has been working in the game industry for quite some time, working with games and game settings such as Star Trek, GURPS, and RuneQuest. He is also the author of the Cthulhu Mythos-style books called Mini Mythos, with titles such as Where the Deep Ones Are, Antarctic Express, and Clifford the Big Red God. And I have to tell you, I put them in my Amazon wish list as soon as I found them.
You can add Goodnight Azathoth to that wish list, because that will be out this summer.
Oh, wonderful.
Yes.
Okay, well, that's definitely going on the list. He, too, is also a podcaster, along with his co-host Robin Laws, of the podcast called Ken and Robin Talk About Stuff. Welcome, sir, to the Adventure Party.
Thanks for bringing me in and letting me join you for this expedition through our metaphorical dungeon of podcasting.
Really appreciate it. We are going to, as we do in every show, we're going to roundtable the different sections of our show, which include the game review, gaming news, and an interview with our guest. We're going to kick that off now with Glenn Bittner's review of an interesting game from North Star Games. Please, tell us a bit about that.
This game is called Evolution, and it's kind of a resource, in a way, kind of a resource management type game, where each player, you have to adapt your species. You basically start with a couple of different species, and you're adapting them to the ecosystem. You want to make them bigger, stronger, higher in numbers, stuff like that. But in order to do that, you have to keep them safe, and you also have to keep them fed. The gameplay is really interesting, where you draw cards, depending on how many species you have, and then the first thing you're going to do is you're going to take one of those cards and you're going to play it face down into a communal pot, basically. Because all the cards are upgrades that you can give your species, but every card also has a number value to it, which will be used to determine how much food is at the watering hole each turn. And any creature that is not a carnivore has to get their food from the watering hole. Now, you then take the rest of your cards, and you can do things such as play them face up to give your species different advantages. You might give yourself a long neck, meaning you can get more food. You might give yourself like a hard shell to protect yourself from carnivores, or you may even upgrade yourself to a carnivore, where now, instead of eating from the watering hole, you eat other player species, which okay. Happened to me too often in this game. but you have to manage everything, because you can also make your creatures bigger. Because if you're bigger, carnivores can't eat you as easily, because a carnivore can only eat something smaller than it. You have to make sure you have more numbers, because the more numbers you have, the less likely you are to go extinct.
Sure.
Because if you hit zero on the number track, your species goes extinct. You can also add more species if you want. So it's all managing all these different things, because the food is at the beginning of the game, there's going to be more food than anyone can eat.
Okay.
And food is actually how you score points. Because every time you eat, you place your food in this little bag. At the end of the game, you total up how many food you have in your bag, and that's whoever's the most is going to win. Plus, you get bonuses for the population of your species and then different traits as well. But food's where you're going to score the most of your points. It's a hoot. I like this game a lot. And I was really surprised when I first heard that North Star Games made it, because up until this point, North Star Games did party games. Their most well-known game is Wits and Wagers, which is basically a trivia kind of betting trivia game. And when this one came out, I actually had one of the guys who works for North Star came to our store and demoed it. He's actually friends of one of my coworkers. And when I mentioned my surprise of them making it, he goes, yeah. He goes, this is the kind of game that everyone who works in North Star Games plays and wants to make, but they made the party game first because they knew that it would sell, and would then let them have the ability to make a game like Evolution. So
okay, sure.
Huh. But it plays pretty quickly once you understand the rules. Average play time is about an hour. It's 2 to 6 players. It's can be very competitive, although you do at times get a bit of cooperation amongst people where the carnivores will divvy up who they're going to eat. although carnivores can eat each other, and one trick too is if there isn't anything for a carnivore to eat, you might be eating your own species, because if you have 2 species and your carnivore can't eat anyone else except your own other guy, he'll eat your other guy. So you have to be careful, because you might end up eating yourself into extinction. So, okay. It's a really nifty game. It's got beautiful art on the cards, too. Sorry about that. It's a really fun game from a company that I wasn't expecting it from.
Huh.
How does it compare to Urzupa? The other, sort of the big amoeba in the evolutionary games world.
You know, I have not played that one.
Oh.
So.
Well, I haven't played this one, so we're 2 halves of the locket, and we haven't been joined.
And actually, I had someone ask me that exact question yesterday, and I just haven't been able to look that one up yet, because it's been pretty hectic at work the last day and a half.
Yeah, well, no doubt.
All right. So, highly competitive, would you say, in that hour?
It starts off, everyone's all friendly and nice, because everyone starts off as just an herbivore. You all eat the plants that are growing at the watering hole. But as soon as someone plays carnivore, all bets are off. Then the carnivore, they're going to contribute as little food as possible to the watering hole. Because they want everyone else to stay small and weak so they can just keep eating them. So aside from having to run away from carnivores, you're also then competing for food like mad. So you want to get upgrades that let you get, like long neck lets you take extra food. And there's some things, there's like scavenger, which if the carnivore kills someone and eats them, you just take an extra food out of the watering hole because you're scavenging the remains. So competition for food becomes very fierce even amongst the herbivores, because the food supply dwindles. The bigger species get, the more they need to eat.
Sure. Oh, okay. Wow, that sounds like a really... It doesn't sound like a beer and pretzels kind of a game? Or would you classify it as really...
More of a twigs and steaks.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I think it's casual enough, because, I mean, it depends how many people are playing. It can get kind of crazy. I played it with 6, and that gets crazy because it's a lot of people to keep track of with their species. Because most people will be running 1 to 3 species. So even if everyone's only running 1, now you got to keep track of 6 different species plus all their upgrades, then most people are going to have 2. So now you're talking 12 species with all their upgrades. So now it's like, okay, so you've got the guy who is size 4, but because of this upgrade, he hunts at a size 6. So I got to make sure my guy's bigger than a size 6 to not get eaten by you. But if I'm too big, this guy over here has all these upgrades to let him take extra food, so I won't be able to feed my guy, so he's going to die anyways. So maybe I'll focus on my other person over here. So there's a lot to keep track of. So if you have too many beers, I think you're going to miss out on everything that's going on.
So it's a survivalist resource management game.
Yes.
Okay. Very interesting. All right. Well, thank you for that, sir. We're going to jump into the news here. Modiphius to create games based on John Carter series of books. Modiphius is going to be making a couple of new games based on John Carter, which was written by Edgar Rice Burroughs. Modiphius has announced two games based on the material, an RPG and a board game, and they will be releasing some collectible miniatures for the RPG as well. John Carter, the role-playing game, is set for a Christmas 2015 release, so just a few months away here. It will use the 2D20 light system, also used in Mutant Chronicles Infinity and the Conan RPGs. Characters will be able to explore Barsoom, which is the Martian name for Mars, as we call it on Earth, from its deserts to its ancient cities. There will be stats for all the major characters from the books. And to help augment the RPG, there will be the miniatures that I mentioned before, which are being released spring of 2016. Now, also being released that spring of 2016 is John Carter, Warlord of Mars, which is a board game that will allow the players to save Barsoom from all the all evils, from scientists to ancient forces to other things. I like how they sinisterly put the dot, 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 other things. This article was from Tabletop Gaming News. Now, I've had the opportunity to play the Conan RPG, which was a lot of fun and very true to the feel of the books. And who here saw the John Carter of Mars movie?
Do I really have to admit that?
You don't have to if you don't want to. That's all right. Kenneth?
Happily, I saw the trailer first, and so it was like, well, if you don't want me to see the movie, then I certainly don't want to see the movie. I mean, that just seems fair, right, Disney? I mean, why would I question them? They edited the trailer, right?
You know, and their whole marketing strategy, originally it was The Princess of Mars, and then they changed gears and changed the title, and that was, at that point,
they figured that boys wouldn't want to see something called Princess of Mars, so they changed it, and then no one saw it.
Oh, it's a wonderful film, and directed by okay, now we're turning into a movie review podcast, and I apologize for that, but Andrew Stanton is the guy who created Finding Nemo, and he was the director of this film, and it's a shame it got a bad rap. It was a lot of fun, but going back to Edgar Rice Burroughs, it's kind of cool to see a company that already has the Conan property, and I don't know if you gentlemen have had an opportunity to partake of the Conan RPG, but it's to me, it's very comforting to know that a company that has done Edgar Rice Burroughs right is going to be picking up this property as well and adapting
Conan it. Conan is not Edgar Rice Burroughs, though. Conan is Robert E. Howard.
Oh my God! Yes,
Brad.
I know. Now I feel terrible.
I mean, it's still sword fights and brunettes. So I mean, you're half right. But,
now I'm embarrassed. All right, but in my defense, their styles are not dissimilar. I'm trying to redeem myself. Here.
They're both dead.
Well, there's that too. Well, to me, the adaptation of Conan is so solid. You know, magic is not as wondrous as D&D magic. It does stay true to Howard's vision. So it's kind of cool to see them getting the chance to do something like that with this property.
Yeah, I mean, Modiphius has generally done a pretty good job with their various licensed properties all the way across the board. So I assume as long as whoever the sort of lead designer or whatever has got a genuine love and understanding of the Barsoom novels, I think it'll probably be, you know, just as successful as the other Modiphius stuff has been in terms of recapturing that original spark.
Sure.
Do you know who the designer is, or just the company?
I just know I just know the company, but let me check. I do have a link from the company, from Modiphius, and I want to see if they mention... No, they don't. They don't seem to have a, or they're not mentioning if they have a designer assigned to it and who it is.
If it's coming out in Christmas, the designer is already, you know.
Well, yeah, no, absolutely. That's not something you put together in a month.
Pretty much done with it, actually.
I should say, yeah, it should be at the editing and printing phase at this point if they're going to get it out. You're absolutely right.
Or at the very least in the, you know, art and everything else phase.
Sure.
Yeah, no, I'm sure that they've got someone, and then they just didn't put it in the press release for some reason. You know, foolish economy of space, perhaps. Anyway, perhaps. But the larger point is that they've done a good job on their other licensed properties, so this would be one of those that if you're interested in John Carter, give it a look and see if it appeals to you, right?
Yeah, and, no, absolutely.
And again, planetary romance and sword and sorcery are not so far apart that you can't make some judgment based on how well they did Conan, because at least it means they're not just simply porting the same thing back and forth. They're paying some attention to the nature of the world. So yeah.
Gosh, you'd hope so. if it's gonna be successful, absolutely. Glenn, have you ever had a chance to check out the Conan RPG?
I have not checked out a Conan RPG since the 80s.
Oh, fair enough.
Like three but Conan RPGs I, ago.
I have looked a bit at something else from Modiphius, which is the Octum Cthulhu. So World War II type Cthulhu stuff with Nazis and all that. So,
oh.
One of the people at work has picked up everything available for it and is planning on running a campaign.
Nice. Of course,
at a game store, we're always planning on running campaigns that we never do.
True enough. That kind of sounds like that would be in your wheelhouse, Kenneth, the Octum Cthulhu.
Yeah, Sarah Newton, I guess, is sort of doing a lot of the writing for that. She's a good friend and a fine designer and researcher. And I wrote a little tiny bit in the Keeper's Guide for Octum Cthulhu because Chris Birch wanted me to explain why you don't blame the Nazis on the Cthulhu mythos and how to handle the sort of presence of two very different kinds of evil in your horror role-playing game. And I did it like two pages out of 180, so I just barely am in the book at all. But Chris liked it, and I thought that it was the sort of thing that's important to say, because otherwise you end up saying, oh, well, it's not the Nazis' fault. It was Nyarlathotep that did that. And it's like, no, it kind of was the Nazis' fault. They were horrible, horrible people, and you can't let them off the hook just by blaming, you know, Haster or somebody.
True enough.
Yeah.
Okay. Very cool. Well, we are going to extend our news here a little bit further. We're going to have Ryan Murphy take over. He is the contributor to Galactic Netcasts, who offers us the Galactic Gaming News, and he covers more of the digital beat of gaming, and he has a brand new update for us. So take it away, Ryan. All right, thanks for that report, Ryan. Appreciate it. Next up, we're going to get into the Kickstarter spotlight, and we are going to recap last week's pick, which was Brawl, which was an updated cheap-ass card game. And Glenn, that was your pick, so give us a little bit of insight on that.
So when we looked at it last week, they still had a bit to go to their goal of 30,000. They have now passed their goal. They're at 35,361. They got 5 days left.
Nice.
Just quick recap, Brawl is a super fast two-player fighting game where you have you are trying to win base cards by playing more hits on your side of the table and playing blocks to stop hits from your opponent. And when I say it's super quick, I'm talking a game takes under 2 minutes.
It's a no-fooling-around game.
No-fooling-around, so...
And if you get a chance to, if you've seen in our show notes, you can click in there and you can see the listing for Brawl and watch the video. Watching the two gentlemen
definitely
play
the
game, the two gentlemen play the game, and it's moving. So it's something where you need to pay attention to detail, and if you don't, you're gonna lose. So
you only have 5 days left.
Yeah, and for the cost of what it takes to get in, $21 gets you two different Brawl decks, which is the minimum that you need to play. So $21 to get in on a game, that's next to nothing. That's really cool. And if you jump in at, what is it? You can get all six decks.
At 51.
At $51. And combined between, they had a $52, which was the early bird. There's, 428 backers at that level to get all six games. So people were really hot to get this game again. Because this is a re-release, we talked about this. This is a re-release of the cheap ass game. And I'm trying to think of, I had a question and now it's gone. Was it the same structure as, I mean, this is just a re-release. There's no updates. It's just a re-release of the game, correct?
Just a re-release as far as I have been able to ascertain so far. I probably, if it's like most of the releases, they probably updated the artwork.
Sure, yep.
But that's about it. It's pretty much the same game.
Okay. And, they passed it by, which is very good news. And, you know, for a name like Cheapass, who has established themselves with making wonderful, wonderful games at a low cost, you know it's going to be good. And because it's a re-release, you know that this has been thoroughly tested and appreciated and well-loved. So it's great to see that they surpassed their goal, and this is definitely going to happen. And it will be released, the estimated delivery, is January of 2016. So right around the corner here. In the grand scheme of things. All right. Well, we're going to talk about our spotlight, our new spotlight, which is called The Voting Game, which is, it's a party game. So we've got a little bit of a theme going there. It's billed as a game where you find out who your friends really are. To me, it kind of reminded me a little bit of, at least in the packaging structure, of Cards Against Humanity. It's a kind of a simple black box, but inside of it are questions that you ask the group. It can play up to 10 players, which I thought was... let me just double check that.
It says plays up to 10, but I love the asterisk of the, who are you kidding? You don't have 10 friends.
Yes. Now, the box comes with questions, and it comes with numbers. So what ends up happening is the question card is flipped over, and it asks a question such as, who would survive the longest zombie apocalypse? And then everybody, face down, puts down the player number. So everybody is given a number. And then everybody puts down their number card as to who they think would... in this particular case, survive the longest in a zombie apocalypse. And then it's scored by how many times you particularly win each question. It's really, really kind of a neat concept. And they've already got expansions. They have a NSFW expansion. There is a fill-in-the-blank expansion. And there is a Create Your Own, which is 80 blank cards that you can make up to 80 more questions to maybe it's more inside jokes for your group or things like that. It puts the control in your hands to expand the game, which is really kind of a neat concept. $25 gets you in at the ground floor to get the original, the core game of voting. $50 gets you all three expansions, which is really kind of cool. And if you decide to go big, you can spend $90 and get two copies of the core game and two copies of each of the three expansions, which is really kind of cool. looking at this right now, their goal is 7,500. And with 30 days to go, they're at 4,000, just about 4,500. So they are more than halfway there. So this looks like something that's going to absolutely happen. So based on what I've seen here, it looks like this would be a very, very fun game. Doesn't take too long to play. And it's kind of like, and I know you don't like Cards Against Humanity, Glenn. and I don't know, Kenneth, if you had an opportunity to play Cards Against Humanity.
Oh, yeah, I've played it.
And it's a game where really nobody wins. You all lose a piece of your soul. It's kind of a neat approach to doing a party game like that can include a lot of people and be entertaining. Would you, based on that short overview that I gave it, does that sound like something that you guys would play if you were at a party?
Well, I mean, if I'm at a party, I'm there to socialize. So if everyone else is playing, you know, their, you know, Cards Against Humanity or that or Werewolf or whatever, you do it because that's why you're there, right? That's just politeness. Would I break it out and say, hey, guys, let's do this instead of drink and have fun? No, of course not. But, you know, one is not always in charge. That's what I've found out in this life.
That is very true. That is very true. Glenn. What say you?
If people wanted to play it, I would play it with them, but I would probably enjoy this more than Cards Against Humanity because there's at least a little bit of room for creativity, which is my biggest complaint with Cards Against Humanity is that there's no, it's just simply, oh, okay, I will play Auschwitz because that's offensive. There, I'm done. And this, you know, in this, you might have to put a little more thought into it. And I can see there actually being more discussion after the answers are revealed with the person who's like, why do you think she would last in the zombie apocalypse? She'd be the first one to die. You are all idiots.
As opposed
to someone just going and crying, because they actually know a child with ass cancer, and that's not really that funny.
Yeah, I'd give you that. Yeah, I could see that making or breaking the voting game, making or breaking some friendships, for sure. And it's going to be an interesting, you know, we all have our own personal view as to, you know, what we can and can't do and what we're all about. And to get that chance to see yourself through somebody else's eyes could be a wonderful experience or leave you curled up in a ball crying in a corner of the room. So. Yeah.
Well, right now, everyone, not everyone, but a lot of people are trying to be the next Cards Against Humanity. They want to be the game that everyone wants to play and everyone wants to own and they can sell, you know. And they want to be the guys who can say, hey, you know what, we're going to sell poop in a box and people are going to buy it and people will buy it and we'll sell out. These people, they want to be that next, you know, that next person who can do that.
Yeah, and Cards
Against Humanity. Effort, maximum reward.
Yeah. That's the American dream, isn't it?
I think it's a lot of people's dreams, actually. I mean, there you have people who really do work hard, but a lot of people, if it's the, hey, if you could put in 5 hours of work and get $1 million, would you do it? Most people are going to say, yeah, I'll do it.
Well, I don't know, 5 hours, that's a lot. I mean, like all at once or just spaced out over a week? What are we talking about?
I mean, maybe a week.
Yeah, all right, maybe. We'll talk. Just send me the prospectus, and we'll get on that.
And that's the thing too is they want to be that because some people are people who haven't worked in the game design field at all. Just think that I make a game and I'll just make $1 million. No, that's not most game designers.
Well, I mean, Cards Against Humanity sort of managed to, you know, strike while the iron was hot. It had a really great graphic look, which is, I think, a big part of it. And it managed to ride that sort of viral wave really, really well. So, you know, regardless of its merits or demerits as a thing you do with friends, allegedly, you have to look at the way that they handled the actual marketing production. All the professional hard part, you know, to me, of game design, the part where you get your game out in front of people's eyeballs, make people talk about it, that's something that, you know, when it happened, it wasn't just a flash in the pan. They're still, you know, cranking along. I mean, Max and the guys are in Chicago, so I've met them, and I've got friends who are, like, you know, in business relationships with them. So it's, you know, they're still, you know, moving along, and they're trying to move from strength to strength. But there's plenty of people that I know that who have been handled or who have been handed massive success and managed to piss that away because they had no idea what to do with it. And that, I think, is the real difference, right, as to who's going to stick around. It's not entirely your game design chops, although it helps that Cards Against Humanity isn't obviously broken, possibly because there's barely a mechanic to it, as you alluded to earlier. But but the ability to present it, sell it, market it, expand on it and reinforce it, those are things that are not easy to do either. And so they deserve all the credit for that and for, you know, trying to stay in the field and, you know, come back to it. So, you know, it's not an either or, but just like after Magic came out, like you said, you know, everyone wanted to be the next Magic cards. I mean, you know, you got, you know, 150 cards with crappy art on them and surely people will trade them. That didn't happen either. And so I think a lot of people are looking at that sort of adult party game space that Cards Against Humanity pioneered or re-pioneered, because it had been around a lot before in other games, but pioneered for this century at least. And they're saying, well, can we get into that? Is that space, like Magic turned out to be, a space that's big enough for other huge successes? Or is it going to be something where, no, there's just one game and a bunch of little sort of orbiting wastes of everyone's valuable time? But you'd feel like an idiot if you had the next Yu-Gi-Oh! Or Pokemon and you were like, nope, I'm pretty sure that category's full. We're never going to make another, you know, after Magic, no more card games. No more CGs, right? So, you know, I think it just makes sense to give it a shot and see what happens. And again, I think you're right that, you know, seeing yourself as others see us is not a bad, you know, sort of sub-theme or sub-harmonic or whatever. The thing that it does is it actually gets people to have to, because of the rules, say what you think of me, which is what everyone wants to actually talk about, is tell me about me.
No, that's very true. And I'm assuming if you are playing this game in a party atmosphere and alcohol is involved, I'm sure that things will probably get very truthful and very real fairly quickly. Especially as the evening goes on.
It could happen, that's for sure.
Well, they just watch one of the videos where they have drunk voting game with beer and board games.
Okay. All right. Well, I'm so glad that we got you on the show, Kenneth. I had originally reached out to Pelgrane Press to talk about Gumshoe. I had a few friends that... one in particular who had never really run a system before and heard about Gumshoe and what it was about, and that really appealed to her because it really focused more on the mystery, at least through her description, through the mystery, and not so much the mechanics of the dice rolling. And while it is a part of
very
it.
Very minimal. So, you know, it's a game that rewards story planning and story thinking about more than it rewards mechanical mastery, just because there's so few mechanics to master, right? So wind up spending your extra cycles, you know, writing, you know, adventures and thinking about how do I present this clue in an interesting way.
No,
and I have to give props to any game with Trail of Cthulhu. I know I can't remember the exact skill name, but it's basically run away,
fleeing.
Yes.
Which, in that mythos, is a very valuable skill, and you should probably have a lot of points in that.
And you can buy it for half cost.
Yes.
So it's like almost like charisma in the hero champions sort of universe.
Charisma is the dump stat. Fleeing is actually useful.
Well, yeah, that's the other thing there, is that's far more useful as a skill. So as I had reached out and I had some back and forth with them, and they mentioned that we should be speaking with you, and I dug into your career a bit more, and I got to say, wow, you've done so many wonderful things and have been a part of a lot of great projects. And you are just wrapped up the Dracula dossier for, excuse me, for Night's Black Agents. Would you tell us a little bit about that? And then we'll kind of get back into Gumshoe.
Sure. The Dracula dossier is, well, it began as two books, and now I think it's 9 or 10 because of the stretch goals and other foolishness. But the core of it is the two books, and one book is Dracula Unredacted, which is Bram Stoker's novel with all of the sources and methods and information put back into it that reveals that British intelligence tried and failed to recruit a vampire in 1894, and everything went wrong. And Bram Stoker was brought in to write the after-action report, and when he turned it in, they were like, well, we can't publish all of that because it will reveal what we did. So they cut out a bunch of it and then published the novel as disinformation.
Oh, that's
so
beautiful.
So this novel, then, sits in British intelligence archives, and over the years, over the decades, MI6 keeps coming back to that well, and what's called Operation Edom, which is the attempt to recruit Dracula, gets reactivated in 1940 because they want to bring Dracula into World War II to stop Hitler from taking over Romania. So in 1940, the SOE team goes into Romania, and one of the survivors annotates that first draft of Dracula. Then in 1977, there's a mole hunt because British secrets are showing up in Romania, and they're like, who... how can there be a back channel we don't know about between Britain and Romania? And Operation Edom is like, oh, that may be because of the immortal Romanian who was wandering around London with mind control powers. That probably could be what happened. And so Edom is tasked with finding the mole, and one of the analysts on the mole hunt annotates that same first draft of Dracula.
Oh.
And then in 2005, after 7/7, the British intelligence community is like, literally anything is on the table. We've got to stop terrorism from hitting Britain again. And Edom is like, well, if anything is on the table, we happen to know a monstrous killer that really hates Muslims, because Dracula, of course, spent his whole actual lifetime fighting against the Ottoman Turks. So that could work. So they reactivate Dracula and point him at Al-Qaeda and ISIS and other terror groups, which, of course, has huge collateral damage and is a terrible idea. And in 2011, enough information gets out that another analyst elsewhere in MI6 finds the copy of the Dracula dossier, finds the copy of Stoker's first draft and annotates it, and then she disappears. Oh. And so now you, the players, have this document, which is the full story of Dracula with three generations of MI6 analyst annotations in it. From that, you can then follow those clues anywhere. And the director's handbook, which is the companion book to Unredacted, is where all the clues lead. So we have, I think we on the back says 64, but it's actually more than that, NPCs, and any one of them might be innocent, they might be an Edom asset, or they might be a minion of Dracula. And you, the players, pick, we want to go investigate that seismologist because he sounded weird in the annotation. And when you meet him, the GM, the director is what we call him in Night's Black Agents, decides, well, is this guy going to be on the level? Is he going to be still working as part of Edom? Or is he going to be a Dracula asset, a Dracula minion? And then that changes the nature of the game. So it's an improvisational collaborative campaign. There's no preset, you will do this and then this and then this. Sure. The players pick what they do. The players may say, we'll just go find Castle Dracula and hunt him down there because we know he's got to be hanging out there. There's a big page, there's actually a dozen pages or so in the book, how to find Castle Dracula. Which of the 9 possible castles might it be? What's there? Is it active? Is it not active? Is it a tourist trap? Is it, you know, a desolate ruin? And you, then get to decide all of those things and also decide while you're doing it, well, what's between you and Dracula's castle? Is it just the, you know, the Ruvari Sigani, his ancient servitors? Is it Slovakian mafia guys? Is it the Romanian secret police? Who else is trying to stop you from doing this? Meanwhile, of course, Operation Edom wants to know what happened to its copy of the Dracula dossier, and it's hunting you. So you've got basically two sets of people who will just basically legitimately kill you, and you have to follow clues in order to stay ahead of both of them. And that's sort of the game, and it becomes ideally sort of a big, you know, sort of world-defining campaign for your Knights Black Agents game. And at the very least, it gives you an excuse to go reread Dracula, which is always good as far as I'm concerned.
Wow. That, I, you know, some of the best, in my experience, some of the best stories, some of the best games that you will ever experience, as long as the storyteller or the director or the game master is passionate about that particular historical event, is making a fictional setting that uses the truth, or at least the perceived truth of events, and working you as a fictional as a group of fictional characters into that, and well, navigate that.
Describe my entire career, or at least my entire non-Star Trek career. Yeah,
well, exactly. And looking, you know, especially at your love of Lovecraft and the work that you've done in that mythos, especially, you know, when you get to like Trail of Cthulhu and things like that. It looks like that's really, really in your wheelhouse, and it sounds, you know, based on your description, you really just go down that rabbit hole and give a lot of options for people to explore a lot of those different worlds or mythos in the case of Lovecraft. That's wonderful. Now, one of my questions is, especially now getting back into Gumshoe, When you created Trail of Cthulhu, it mentions that it's licensed from Chaosium. How do you navigate something like that when somebody owns and I'm going to make an assumption here that they basically own sort of the game versions of H.P. Lovecraft, or how does that work? How do you license from Chaosium, and what are you particularly licensing from them?
I have not seen what their license is with Arkham House and with the other creators. Okay. So what we've got is a safe harbor where, because we've licensed Call of Cthulhu, we can use anything in the mythos that Call of Cthulhu has used in the mythos.
Okay.
We can use anything they've invented for, say, Mass of Nyarlathotep or Escape from Innsmouth or any of their other really great Chaosium products. We can then use that in Trail of Cthulhu products if we decide we want to. So we don't have to go back to Brian Lumley if we decide we want to put something in, because Chaosium has already gone to Brian Lumley, right, in theory. Sure. And they've got, you know, stats for his monsters and whatever in their books, and so we can just go and take it. And so when you work, because Lovecraft is in the public domain, Robert E. Howard is in the public domain, parts of Robert Bloch's early stuff are in the public domain, August Derleth is not in the public domain, which is what will catch you, because he contributed a lot more to what we think of as the mythos than a lot of people remember. Like Biaki are his. If you use a Biaki, you're, you know, taking Derleth, you're not doing Lovecraft, so.
Okay.
Or at least if you call it that. But what going through Chaosium does is it lets us just not have to worry about what's in public domain and what's not, and just do whatever we want to do, as long as Chaosium has already done it in a supplement somewhere. And since they've been doing, you know, supplements for 30 odd years, going on 40 years, I guess now. They've got lots of stuff that we can borrow from and sneak into our game and maybe give it our little half turn and put our spin on it. But, you know, in theory, you can write your own Lovecraft-based role-playing game and have a great time with it, but getting a sub-license from Chaosium, I think, is, A, just kind of polite, because they did sort of pioneer the whole field, and it's the whole reason anyone's buying your game in the first place. And, B, in our case, at least, it does make, you know, creative decisions a lot broader and a lot more open, because we have so much more to choose from than we would if we were just trying to, you know, run in that same little path of definitively public domain stuff.
Sure. Okay. Now, I want to kind of ask a more personal question. Knowing that you do appreciate H.P. Lovecraft a great deal, and in hearing you speak of Lovecraft, you know the mythos. I'd be willing to bet inside and out. What is it about Lovecraft's work, or the mythos in general, that appeals to you so much?
Well, I mean, there's sort of a lot of different levels of. I mean, part of it is what you were talking about the notion of real history being tangled up in fictional events.
Sure.
I mean, that's great fun, whether you're, you know, talking about your, you know, role-playing game campaign, my Dracula dossier tied up with actual World War II, whether it's the Flashman novels, whatever it happens to be. And Lovecraft, of course, said every supernatural story, every weird story works best as a hoax. Works best if you put so much realism around it that when you stick the one weird thing in, people don't twig to it immediately, and then it really messes with them. And that is what I like about the mythos, is that the mythos is, by definition, interweaved with reality. The whole point of the mythos is to reveal to us the actual truths of our reality, that our history is longer than we understand, that our world is less important than we understand, that our humanity is less important than we understand, but that all of these come through a scrim of real archaeology, real history, real paleontology, as real as you can get. I mean, Lovecraft was working with cutting-edge science when he was writing stuff, and then putting the myth in behind it, and I think that the chance to do that is what makes it, you know, so much fun. So, first of all, you have that that nature of the interplay between the real and the fictional in a way that, say, you don't with Tolkien or with Forgotten Realms or whatever. And so I think it's just more fun there. I think it also, Lovecraft happens to be a really terrific writer, and so just reading the source material is great fun. And again, you know, I dodged the bullet at Wizards of the Coast of having to work on the Wheel of Time books, and I dodged the bullet from what was it? It was the Tristat system guys. Of they offered me the line developership of the Song of Ice and Fire books, and I started reading those, and it's like, well, this is like the Wars of the Roses, but without the actual part that's interesting about the Wars of the Roses. They just put in some dragons and direwolves, and well, now I don't care. So I left that project because, again, there's no connection to reality, and also because Martin is, you know, he's not at his best, I think, in that sort of long-form style. I think his short stories and his horror novels, his earlier stuff, was considerably better. I'm obviously in the remotely small minority commercially, but, you know, I don't think it's his prose style necessarily that gets people coming back and back to those novels. I think it's just the unfolding of the dire, horrible action, and people just want to know, you know, what beloved character is going to get it in the next. Not so much, oh, I really want to reread that paragraph because it was stellar. But with Lovecraft, you can reread that paragraph for decades, and you're noticing things that he does with parallelism, you're noticing things that he does with tone, you're noticing, once you start reading him as describing the story as an architect describes a house, right? Lovecraft was a giant architecture fan, but once you recognize that and you recognize that that's part of how he writes stories, how he constructs stories, you have a new way to read Lovecraft. It's genuinely literature, I think, in the sense that you can always come back to it. You can always find something new in it, whereas there's tons of perfectly good books that I reread all the time, but it's just, you know, like taking a hit of heroin. It's not actually because it's an intellectual challenge. It's because I enjoy, you know, going back to that, you know, time and place or that spaceship or whatever, and seeing it happen all over again. But with Lovecraft, you genuinely re-engage with the prose and you re-engage with the philosophy. And so that's just great fun, you know, by itself. And the mythos is hugely gameable in a way that other fictional settings aren't, because the characters are so weak. Right, I mean, Henry Armitage is probably the strongest character in the whole mythos, or in Lovecraft's oeuvre, and he is—he's no Hamlet, right? He's no Raskolnikov. But the thing is, he's not even Conan, right? And the thing about a Hyborian Age game is, without Conan, it always feels a little empty. Like you're always going, "Oh, I wonder what Conan is doing. Is he having more fun than us? I'll bet he is." But if you're in the Lovecraft universe, you know you're having a more interesting personal story than Nathaniel Wingate Peasley, because you're reacting to it in a human way. And Lovecraft did not value characterization. He thought characterization was a waste of time in weird fiction. And you can say he's right or he's wrong. Obviously, his weird fiction he was right for, maybe not for everybody. Yeah. But because the characters are such ciphers, you can put your player characters into those roles and into those spaces in a way that you can't do if you're like, oh, I'm the other consulting detective besides Sherlock Holmes. Or, you know, I'm the other starship captain besides Kirk and Picard. You know, and I did two Star Trek games in a row, and we knew that everyone who played it, you know, had to get over Kirk flinch or Picard flinch
Yeah. Or
later on, Cisco Flinch, right? Because they were like, oh, well, this is Deep Space Nine, but it's not really Deep Space Nine because I'm not Cisco. And even if they are playing Cisco, they're not playing him the way that, you know, Avery Brooks played Cisco, like a crazed, drunken Shakespearean. They're doing it how they do it. But with Lovecraft, you don't have to worry, oh, am I doing justice to Herbert West? Herbert West is a cartoon. Do whatever you want to Herbert West. No one cares.
Yeah. You know, it's now that you've explained it that way, you know, I look back at the Dunwich Horror and, you know, the Armitage and the other professors show up, they do some stuff, and that's pretty much it. You know, that wasn't the importance of the story. It was the journey of the Whateley family and how the Dunwich Horror came to be.
And the sort of invert theology that he's doing, where he's simultaneously... Yeah. Working in Arthur Machen's, you know, universe, but he's also parodying and travestying everything that Machen believed was the most important, because for Lovecraft, the nihilism was the most important. And
sure.
To write a nihilist Machen story by itself is impossible, and Lovecraft did it, and he did it great.
See, so
it's just an amazing piece of work on a lot of levels, on a whole ton of levels, as well as just the physical, you know, the quality of the prose is great. That's one of the best first lines in weird fiction, right? Is when a man takes the wrong fork in the road at Dean's Corners, he later discovers he was on the road to Dunwich. It's like, oh, the wrong fork in the road. That's so perfect.
Yep.
But you know, Armitage, like I say, he's the closest thing there is in Lovecraft to a character with, you know, personality, because he's got two whole dimensions to him. But you know, he's just not, you know, he's not even James Bond, right? He's just emptier than that. And so, you know, you run the risk, you know, maybe of worrying about Armitage. And so we sort of faced that head on when we did the Armitage Inquiry campaign frame in Trail of Cthulhu, where Armitage is sort of this doddering ancient retired guy who can't go out and fight monsters anymore because he's like 80 or something in continuity by this time. So he sends you out, and so you're like, oh, I know where Armitage is. He's back in the library taking his, you know, arthritis medicine. That's why he's not out here stopping the Oxothoth, because he'll literally fall apart.
Yeah. Well, I mean, even in Dunwich Horror, he, you know, going through the diary and everything, he's falling apart there.
Yeah, mentally. He nearly kills himself decoding the diary.
Yeah.
Another great Machen touch, right? The notion that the diary is actually poisonous and toxic and damages you from... It's the closest there is in Lovecraft to the thing that people think is in Lovecraft, of a book that will injure you by reading it.
Yeah.
You know, with love, that doesn't happen, right? You don't read the book and then, you know, your face melts off. It's not the arc with the Nazis.
Sure.
What happens is you read the book and then later you see something, you're like, oh, crap, that crazy mythology was real. Now my whole worldview is turned upside down.
Yeah.
But with, you know, reading the diary, the Whateley diary is almost, you know, crippling to Armitage, and he nearly kills himself deciphering it. So it's a very interesting story in a lot of ways, and I think then that's because Machen did believe that there were books that would injure you. Machen believed in writing that was pernicious and evil and wrong, and so for Lovecraft to do a proper Machen story, there had to be a thing that was like that.
And looking at, you know, and we're kind of straying off just a touch.
Oh, we're really straying off.
Well, I mean, but we're still, I mean, Trail of Cthulhu is still a project that you're part of. The whole, you know, in Chaosium, the sanity mechanic and knowing things that you shouldn't know or man wasn't meant to know,
mm-hmm.
you know, wearing you down, grinding you down, and can ultimately destroy you just is such a wonderful mechanic, I think.
Yeah, it's one of the greatest mechanical decisions ever made in the history of role-playing. It's one of the reasons that Sandy Peterson will always be a legend in game design, is because he came up with the reverse of a power fantasy as the way to drive that story, the notion of the death spiral of sanity. And, you know, I tried to sort of... do obeisance to that in Trail of Cthulhu, where you can play in the purist mode or the pulp mode, and in the pulp mode is like regular Call of Cthulhu, but in the purist mode, you never get sanity back. It just always stays gone.
Okay.
So, we separate it into two things. There's stability and sanity. So stability is what keeps you together when you're facing a monster.
Sure.
Sanity is how connected you are to the human reality of the world. And as your sanity dwindles, the more you realize the human reality is wrong, it drains away. You're gone. That's it. And that was in Sandy's first draft of Call of Cthulhu, that rule. And at Chaosium, they said, well, that's terrible. No one will play our game because it'll be too bleak and horrible. And so they made him put in rules for healing your sanity back.
Yeah.
And so I just said, well, I'm going to go back to Sandy's zeroth draft and sneak it into something and see if people play that way. And, you know, we've had a lot of really successful purist scenarios get published, and we've had a lot of people who play it that way. So I'm happy to sort of be letting people play a Sandy Peterson mechanic, even if I have to design it myself.
Well, that's wonderful. That is wonderful. With Dracula Dossier, we spoke about that earlier. It was a Kickstarter-funded project.
Mm-hmm.
In the time that you've been, you know, a game designer and continue to do so, what do you think of Kickstarter? Do you think it's been a good thing for the gaming community, or do you think it complicates things?
Well, I should preface this by saying I don't own a retail store. And I think, sure, if I own a retail store, then I might have a different opinion.
Okay.
But, or at least a more nuanced opinion. But as a game designer, it's an unalloyed good, because it provides immediate contact between me and my audience.
Sure.
Right? I can say to someone, hey, do you want me to nearly kill myself for 2 years writing about Dracula? And they say, yeah, we'd love to see that. As opposed to me saying, gosh, I hope if I nearly kill myself for 2 years writing about Dracula, I can sell it. Which I'm going to say just right out, I don't work on a project for 2 years if I can't sell it.
Sure.
So the fact that I was able to go to the audience and Pelgrane was able to go to the audience and say, do you guys want this? What do you want to see? Do you want these things that can go along with it? And then they respond as enthusiastically as they did. That gave the whole creative team sort of the impetus to go forward and work on the project. And it also lets us tailor a project to an audience. And then as a solo creator, someone like Jason Morningstar doing Night Witches, the game about playing female biplane pilots in World War II, that's not necessarily a thing that a lot of people are going to buy. But Jason Morningstar, because he can go on Kickstarter, can get the 4,000 people or whatever the number is.
Sure.
The 500, I don't know what the number is because I haven't checked the number of backers. I know I backed it. But he'll be able to say, well, I've been able to hand sell it to those 900 people, and no game store in the world is going to stock that in depth, because why would you? What are the odds that you live in the same town as one of the people who wants to play a female biplane pilot in World War II? But Jason can find those people, and so you can target that audience. And so between the ability to raise capital ahead of time, which is another sort of leveragey advantage, but just in terms of a creative opening, you can write a game about anything in theory, and assuming you can sell it and assuming you can find the audience that wants to buy it.
Yeah.
You can produce more games, and I think more games by and large is good, and more games that people want is so much better. I don't know if you guys were around in the late 90s, the mid-90s, right before the card game boom happened,
yep,
and after White Wolf had come out, and everyone was like, well, I can Photoshop art. I have a better skill system than that. I can do my game. And so it was all the guys who wanted to do D&D, but it like, no, our D&D is better than D&D. And now it was all the guys who wanted to do Vampire, and our Vampire is better than your Vampire, and all Shadowrun, but it's better than Shadowrun. It was just horrible. You'd walk around Gen Con and see these poor guys that had mortgaged their house or something to print 5,000 copies of books, and it's just taking up space in their garage and being a fire hazard, and no one wants it because, of course, they don't want their pretend Shadowrun. They want to get a real Shadowrun. Sure. And it's just awful. And once out of a blue moon, someone would hit a nerve or do a really great job and move forward with it. But so many people wasted so much time and money trying to produce and guess what people want. With a Kickstarter, you put it up, and if no one wants it, you'll find out before you've killed yourself, or at least before you've paid the printer, which is, yeah, you know, the real, you know, rubber hits the road part. Now, again, retailers may look and say, well, you're just, you know, siphoning off all the alpha gamers, and I'm sure that there's some degree of truth to that. But on the other hand, by creating games people want to play, you're reinforcing that game habit. You're making more alpha gamers, possibly. I think probably, you know, Glenn has more to say about that than I do, but
yeah, as far as Kickstarter goes, I think any game store owner that can look at it without just simply of it's the ones who say it's stealing all the alpha gamers. I feel that's the same way as like the AMA and all those and the movie studio is saying, well, pirates are destroying our industry. They're just, you know, people are downloading the movies that we spent, you know, $500 million and we're only making $1 billion. The thing is that, now, then, not to equate it to piracy, but it's the fact that
we're actually selling a game. It's like the opposite.
Yes, but it's the fact that they talk about how, you know, there's this one group out there that's destroying them when it's really not. Because in Kickstarter...
Well, there is, but it's Games Workshop.
Well, yes. with Kickstarter, I probably have at least 30 or 40 titles in my store that were Kickstarted.
Yeah.
So that's 30 or 40 games I wouldn't otherwise have in my store.
Mm-hmm.
We don't get to be the first people to have the game, but you know what? That's not everyone who's going to buy it. If every game stops selling after the Kickstarter, some companies would be like, well, okay, we'll do this one thing. But a lot of companies are like, well, if I can get 6,000 people to back it on Kickstarter, then distributors start saying, okay, yeah, we'll take copies, because that's where a lot of that comes in.
Because you're building the audience for it.
You're creating something that has been impossible virtually
until now.
Yeah.
And then you can look at the Kickstarter campaign, and you'll be able to see how that game was marketed, and so you'll know how to sell it better, maybe.
Now, right? Yes, exactly. And there are some...
It's been more with
some of the companies now. With some of the companies that the established companies that run these, will do retailer levels as well.
Yeah, we had a retailer level for Dracula Dossier.
Yeah, and I wish I had known about that when it was out, because I would have definitely jumped all over that.
Well, if everyone just paid attention to everything I say, have a happier, better life.
So yeah, I mean, you know, it's we. I am a full supporter of Kickstarter. There was a brief time where I'm like, but you know, all these big companies in there, but I'm like, you know, it's knowing more about the industry as I do now from when I did 4 or 5 years ago, I know that, you know, a lot of the big game companies, they still don't have, you know, 50 grand just lying around waiting to take a chance on something.
I mean, yeah, cash flow has always been the nightmare monster in the closet of virtually every game company that doesn't make a good CCG, because you can't count on cash flow outside of release months, and that's just a real, real problem. George Vasilakos, who runs Eden Studios, has a game store in Albany, New York, called Zombie Planet. And that solves his cash flow problem, and it also solves his marketing problem.
Sure.
You know, how do I sell this game to gamers? He sees gamers all day who don't want to buy his game. He's like, oh, right, that's a terrible idea. I shouldn't market it. I shouldn't produce it. I should produce something that does sell. And so if I were a mid-tier game company by myself, which fate, thank God, I've avoided, that would be a really tempting thing to do, would be to try and, you know, combine it with a game store in some fashion. Admittedly, George is just really, really good at running game stores, so it probably would blow up on the landing pad if I tried it. But I think that it's interesting that he's found a way to, you know, have cash flow and also have a lot of other things that a mid-tier game company needs, and then, you know, also provide a good service to the people of Albany. So good for you, George.
And we talked a little bit earlier about Gumshoe, and what would you say if you were to talk to somebody who may have played an RPG system or two, and you wanted to talk to them about Gumshoe? What separates Gumshoe from like a system like, say, D20 or something like that? What is the point that it really shines, would you say?
Well, the point of Gumshoe is that it is optimized for solving mysteries. And mysteries can be as broad as what's going on this planet, like Ash and Stars. They can be as narrow as where's this sniper coming from, like in Knights Black Agents. Or they can be as involute as what horrible alien monstrosity underlies creation in Trail of Cthulhu. But what they do is they make solving mysteries a point of progress into the story, not another delay before you get to the story. Because in Gumshoe, you never fail to find a clue, right? If something is a clue that will move you into the story, you automatically find it. That's just the rule.
Yeah.
Because if you look at, you know, virtually every mystery, what novel, TV, movie, whatever it is, they never show the detective look and say, well, I guess I didn't find anything.
Fade to black. Yeah.
Right, fade to black. It's because that would end the movie, or at the worst, it would just waste a chapter of the novel, right? And even in mysteries with a ton of red herrings, the detective is like, he's finding something. He's finding out eventually that this guy's a red herring. Now, most players don't have the patience to sit through, you know, even five red herrings, to quote Dorothy Sayers, but, you know, you're still finding things out. Peter Wimsey doesn't show up to the door and say, hey, I wonder if I could talk to you about your wife, and they say, go away, Peter Wimsey. He's like, well, there you go. That was it.
Sorry to bother you.
He still gets the, have a good one. no, you still find the clue, right? On CSI, when they do all the luminol on the walls, they don't then say, well, I guess there was no blood spatter, there was no fingerprint. No, they find something, and then that goes to the dude who takes his glasses off, and excitement happens, right? that's what moves you into the story, is finding out the answer, finding out the clue, or finding the clue, and then the story is how do you put those clues together, and once you put them together, what new danger does it lead you into, or what new solution does it offer? In Nice Black Agents, the sort of the thriller economy is... information leads you into danger. Surviving danger gets you more information.
Sure.
Right? And okay. In Trail of Cthulhu, information is poisonous, but you have to ingest enough to understand the bigger poison. Right? In Ashen Stars, information lets you literally solve a scientific or a cultural mystery, right? An anthropological or technological mystery. And so all of those, you know, procedural space show, spy thriller, Lovecraft, you don't think of them, of any of them, when you ask, are these mystery games? But they're all mystery games, because they're all about finding information to get to a set point. And once you have that insight, I think a Gumshoe game moves you through your play space more effectively and more interestingly than saying, okay, roll to see if you spotted the elf footprints. No?
Cricket,
roll,
yeah.
Roll elf lore to see if you recognize the packets of elf crisps they left behind. Didn't make that either. Oh, man, if you don't find the elves, this is going to be a long, boring adventure.
Yeah. And
roll spot hidden to see if you see the elf who's still here napping. No? Really? Well, he is an elf. I mean, the thing is, all that's doing is just frustrating you. And all right, so it's simulating reality, but you're not playing this game to simulate reality. You're playing this game because a story is going to happen at some point. Something.
And it's such a momentum killer, too.
Right? Yeah. And so there are ways around it. Plenty of GMs have sort of house-ruled ways around it. Robin is just the guy who said, well, I'm just going to write down your house rule and put it in the front of the book, and then everyone can play that way. Won't that be great? And so that was the inside of Gumshoe, is that investigative games don't have to stop if you didn't find the clue. They can actually give you the clue, because that wasn't the hard part. The hard part is putting the clues together and making sense of it in time to save a life, or to get out of Vienna, or to find the Shoggoth before it breeds, or whatever it is. And then when you get to the Shoggoth or the vampires in Vienna or whatever it is, you still have to fight the thing, right?
Yeah.
You have an exciting, you know, combat, just like we all love in gaming or whatever it is. And so that, I think, is sort of the key insight of Gumshoe. And Gumshoe is not a better game than other games just of its own. It's optimized for a thing, right? It's like if you say, what kind of car do you want? Do you want a Maserati or a Jeep? It's like, well, am I going to be driving along the corniches on the, you know, coast of France, or am I going to be driving into the woods? Because my answer changes radically, right? And it's two different things that are engineered for the same purpose, even though they both have four wheels and an engine. And I think in a lot of cases, role-playing games can be engineered for specific experiences and specific kinds of handling, and Gumshoe is engineered for that kind of handling. And then Robin and I and Kevin Culp have written games that, you know, play into its strengths, as opposed to writing a game saying, gosh, I hope our rule system works. We know what the rule system can do. We write games around that. And sure. And that's sort of the insight such as it is of Gumshoe. And of course, you can Gumshoe anything. You could say, all right, I'm playing D20 and we just never fail a skill check if it's going to get us more information. Right, yeah. So you never fail your tracking check, your dungeoneering check. You may fail it if that makes the game more interesting, right? If the tracking check is actually, did you get surprise on the elk people or not? But, you know, the if the tracking is just, can you follow them to the actual combat, then yeah, you make it and everyone's happy. So it's not like Gumshoe is anything just gigantic and revolutionary. You can take it and use it in any game you're playing already, but we happen to think that it works really, really well for the games that we've done, because those games are optimized to use that mechanic and to make the most of it and to sort of play off that and produce other kinds of knock-on effects once you start understanding that you're using story economy as opposed to real world, you know, counting bullets or liters of blood.
Yeah.
That opens up a lot of different sorts of game design space, I think.
Sure. No, nothing is worse than killing the momentum of the game because you can't move forward until you find the thing.
Well, that's certainly what we've come to believe at Pograin.
Yeah, and from what I've seen with Gumshoe and what you're telling me, I'm probably going to buy the system tomorrow and try to convince some other folks to play it because
great.
That's right up my alley.
Let me recommend Nice Black Agents because there's a hell of a campaign coming out for it.
When you talked about Dracula's Dossier, that blows me away. That level of, you know, the best lies are wedged between two truths kind of approach to everything, and mm-hmm. that I'm such a firm believer in that whole philosophy that this is totally up my alley. So I will be buying that tomorrow.
Great.
In speaking of creating settings around like Gumshoe or things like that, what kind of recommendations would you make to somebody who is interested in maybe not just creating their own role-playing game system or designing their own, but creating a setting around a system, a pre-existing system like Gumshoe? What kind of recommendations would you make to somebody who would be interested in that?
Well, I mean, there's sort of two ways to answer that. There's sort of the practical way. Make sure that the system you're making things up for already has an installed user base.
Yeah.
Right. So okay. When I did Day After Ragnarok, I did it wrong because I did it for Savage Worlds thinking, well, Savage Worlds really plays the way that I think in my head Day After Ragnarok plays. And I'll just do it as Savage Worlds, and because I know Shane Hensley, he was nice, and he let me have the license for, you know, nothing. And so I put together Day After Ragnarok, and I released it, or rather, Hal released it, and Hal Mangold, my publisher. And it turned out Savage Worlds had a huge, really active, really positive player base. But I stumbled backward into that knowledge, because I didn't know.
Oh, okay.
I discovered that after releasing Day After Ragnarok that everyone was just really, really enthused about new Savage Worlds stuff. But I didn't think of that when I did it. But if I were giving advice to people now, I would say, look online, look who's got a user base that is always talking about their game and ideally talking in a positive way instead of bitching about it. Then write for those people. And if you can grok the mechanics well enough to sort of figure out what kind of stories those are best for telling, then tell those stories in your setting. So Fate is another game system that's got huge numbers of players. Pathfinder, obviously, has got huge numbers of players. And both of those, coincidentally, have basically free systems. You don't have to license. You don't pay for the license, which is my second piece of advice. So there should be lots of people who play it, and you should ideally not have to shell out for a license because you don't need that headache. Once you've done that, then look at the game system you've decided to play with and say, what kind of problems does this solve? What kind of stories does this open up? What kind of world am I telling if I'm telling it in basic role-playing versus a world that I'm telling if I'm telling it in Gumshoe versus a world that I'm telling it if I'm telling it in Fate? And maybe all you want to do is just say, I'm going to adapt this public domain story of schooner fights that no one has ever done before, and I think schooner fighting is the next X-Wings, and I'm going to make a schooner fighting game. And maybe you think any of those games might be a good schooner fighting game, and you, with Fate, it's like, oh, what, the captain really hates the other captain, and so we have to, you know, build aspects back and forth, and so your schooner fighting becomes really personal, and if it's BRP, your schooner fighting becomes very, you know, target, you know, hit location, and lots of rolling of dice and fun things like that, and becomes a more tactical game. And with Gumshoe, the schooner fighting game is all about solving the problems inherent in sea stories, right? You know, how do we get the weather gauge? How do we find out why he's off this coast? How do we figure out what is in this other captain's mind? And it becomes more of a sort of a psychological game if you do it for Gumshoe. And if you do it for Savage Worlds, it's just cannons, swords, what the hell? It's schooner fighting, get to killing. And each of those is going to make its own schooner fighting game, and those are not going to resemble each other on the table. But whatever part of the books or the source material you the world in your head, if you're making it up out of whole cloth, whatever it feels most like, maybe you want to point it towards the game system that plays that way.
Yeah.
Right? So I guess that's sort of my advice is to then, you know, look at what you the list of things of ideas you have in your head, and if one of them matches with a game system that's already out there and is being well played and well supported, write it for that. Knock yourself out. Go crazy. Sure. Then in terms of sort of the aesthetic or formalist question, just make sure that when you design a setting that you always have a through line, right? You have a central conflict, you have a central story, you have a central thing that everything always points back to. So that if you're wind up, you know, off in the edges of the setting, writing something that only you care about, you'll say, oh, right, that doesn't actually speak to my through line. That doesn't speak to my contest. That's not part of what the real story of this world is. I'm just going to take that out. Maybe leave it for a supplement that can be about that thing.
Okay.
Like Nice Black Agents, for example, or not Nice Black Agents. Actually, Nice Black Agents is a different story. But Day After Ragnarok, once I came with the idea, this is the Hyborian Age after World War II, and I wrote everything that didn't feel like Conan, everything that didn't feel like the Hyborian Age, like Robert E. Howard, got cut out. Right. If that part of the world didn't feel like Robert E. Howard, I'm not going to focus on it.
Okay.
But I focus into the sort of sensation of the game that I want to play, and then to a lesser extent, because it's the whole world, the British half of the world is more Professor Quatermass than it is Conan the Barbarian. So the British have to be a little more of that thin red line. James Bond, Professor Quatermass, one Britisher is all that stands between us and destruction type story that the British produced in the desperate, you know, after effect of losing their empire to convince themselves they were still relevant for a while. And that made really great source material and really great stories. So since I wrote a world where it was actually literally true, I could tell those stories. But again, stories that aren't about that kind of individual heroism don't fit, so there aren't any big shooting wars going on in the world, right?
Sure.
It has to be a world of Cold War spies. It has to be a world of weird science to give the Quatermass guys something to do. Okay, what kind of weird science have I got? Well, I've just got a giant alien snake. Let's pull pieces out of that and make it weird biotech. And so every question that I answer, it may seem unrelated, but it all points back to the central thread or the central through line of the setting. And what that means is I don't have to sit there and go, gosh, I wonder what's going on in Patagonia. It's like, well, is it going to be weird science or is it going to be Conan the Barbarian stuff? And if it's neither, then just don't write about it.
Sure.
Because that's what the world is about. It's about those things.
Okay.
And so that's my advice, is don't try and build your setting, you know, like you're writing an encyclopedia or even a history book. Build your setting like you're doing a story Bible for a TV show or for, you know, better yet, a comic book, something that's going to be really, really tightly focused.
Sure.
And present a world where the kinds of stories you want to happen are the kinds of stories that people will tell, because otherwise they'll think that they can walk out on the thin ice that you've left there because you felt like you had to describe something, and they fall through it because it turns out the stories that they want to tell are no good there, or you didn't provide enough material, or it doesn't actually fit. And I think that just angers people and disengages them, whereas if you've got a fundamental story that you can tell in that world, people will want to tell that. I mean, if you look at, I think I probably took a lot of that away from knowing John Zinsser and John Wick when they were doing L5R. You know, so much of that game is just samurai stories. It's all samurais. It's all Yojimbo.
Sure.
If it didn't happen in a Chambara movie, it's not going to happen in L5R. And that sort of aesthetic choice to do that and to only tell as much of Japan as you pretend Japan as you need to get back to Chambara stories. That was a really strong editorial decision and a really strong line decision. And they kind of got away from it a little bit as Rokugan sort of expanded out from under them. Mm-hmm. But obviously, it's still a really strong workable setting in a way that, say, the Traveler Imperium stopped being after they ended the frontier. Because they forgot, oh, that was the big part of our story, was the frontier. That's on us. We screwed that up. So, I mean, look at the kind of stories you think your game is about and make sure that your setting contains those stories and not a bunch of other stupid stories.
Sure. And we had the opportunity to speak with author Patrick Rothfuss, and we kind of talked about the if he were to take his novels and put them into... have a game system that would service and be true to what his books were. You know, he said pretty much the same thing, that, you know, you couldn't do his books in, say, Pathfinder or Dungeons and Dragons. It had to be, you know, I think he kind of settled on fate being something that would work well, because the type of story did not fit with the mechanics of the system. So it definitely rings true. Trying to hammer that square peg into the round hole is just going to leave everybody frustrated, and it's not going to flow very well at all. So
I mean, D&D and Pathfinder are great engines for telling D&D and Pathfinder type stories, right? They're super good for stories where you kick open a door and there's guys in a room and you stab them. It's a great engine for that. It's really, really good for that. And when you read, say, you know, an R.A. Salvatore novel or the Dragonlance stuff, that feels like D&D. And you say, yeah, I can see how D&D works in that. That's a D&D-y type world.
Yep.
It's just that not everything is going to work that way. Even if you try and take stuff that Gary and Dave were using as their inspiration, you try and play Three Hearts and Three Lions as D&D, you'll just be a sad, lonely person because it won't work.
Sure.
Right?
Okay. No, I couldn't imagine it being any other way. And you know, being the person that's trying to construct a story, the amount of hair pulling that you'd end up doing trying to make a mechanic work, you know, in a system that is just not really built for, is just, you know, it's a colossal waste of time. And, you know, trying to find that right system that works for the story you're trying to tell is...
And even if you luck into discovering it, you have to then convince all of the players who, if they're playing in the game of this thing, at least care about it, or they're really nice, which is great. And so buy the pizza for those guys. You're trying to convince them that you're right. And they're like, no, Gandalf doesn't work that way. Gandalf works this way. And, you know, he's 20th level. He's not 5th level. What are you, insane? And so there's, you know, all kinds of, but he's a Valar. He's a whole different thing. And so you wind up spending the whole time knocking heads and disagreeing about the setting as opposed to jointly celebrating the setting for what it's worth.
Sure.
And, you know, I'm generally of the opinion that we have plenty of game systems as it is, but I can understand that if you've got, say, the One Ring, the Tolkien license, or you've got the John Carter license, it might be worth, you know, looking and saying, how do I make this game match this world? Right. And even when we do Gumshoe, we don't just do the same Gumshoe rules over and over and over again. We say, how do I make this investigative game feel like a thriller? How do I make it feel like a serial space exploration game? How do I make it feel like whatever it happens to be? And so those are sort of the decisions that we make, even within the constraints of one game system. So I can understand people. I recommend, in fact, that people look at what other kinds of game systems can apply to your story before you start telling it, not during.
Yeah, absolutely. And I did get a chance to, and I only had time to briefly listen to a little bit of your Ken and Robin Talk About Stuff, which I think is a great title for a podcast, by the way.
That's Robin. As with all of the things that work about that podcast, it was Robin's idea, so.
Please pass that on, because it's such a great, and I like the graphic too for the show.
That's John Kovalik did that, so.
Okay.
I am fortunate in knowing vastly more talented people who let me put my name on their things.
That's a good place to be.
It beats working, I promise you.
One of the things that I noticed, and I just got to listen to a snippet of episode 147, I would encourage people to listen to it just because of, well, one, the vast knowledge that you and Robin both have about the industry, but two, you started to talk about the narrative of how to make your game better by, like, you know, describing a room, I think was the, you know, being especially somebody who may not have a whole lot of confidence in running a game per se, or maybe have never done it at all and are very interested, it sounds like you guys cover topics that can help people be better storytellers, tell a better story, and keep people, get them engaged in the game. What kind of experience have you had with, I mean, you got 147 episodes under your belt. How, I guess, one, how did it come about? And two, what are some of the topics that you guys tend to cover in your podcast?
Well, the topic came about because Robin looked at the Ennies and said, there's an Ennie category that I am not eligible for. That can't stand. And he said, hey, Ken, how about you and I just go out and get ourselves some free Ennies? And it was like, well, all right, I kind of like the sound of that. And also, it's an excuse to talk to Robin for an hour every week, which I totally recommend. Not that you can, haha, because I have that job.
But, well, at least you get to listen in.
But Robin is one of my best friends. And when I just started out, I was just a monstrous, raving Robin Laws fanboy, which is hilarious and still true. But Robin and I get along really, really well, and so I think that comes across in the podcast. It's fun to talk to Robin. Robin thinks it's fun to talk to me. Other people think it's fun to listen to Robin and I talk, and that's where the idea came from, is that if Ken and Robin talk about stuff, people will want to listen to it. Sure. And that seems to have worked out pretty well for us so far. The things we talk about, every episode there's going to be one installment of The Gaming Hut, which is where we give sort of, to the extent that we give anything that's useful, this is useful, oftentimes play-tested, in that Robin and I have both been GMs for forever, how to make your game better. And it might be a world-building thing, it might be a, you know, like you say, a technique at the table that you can use, it might be about pacing, or it might be about whatever. And so every episode there's going to be something about gaming. And it's going to be really gaming-focused and straight-up gaming-focused. And then there's usually going to be a thing called Ken's Time Machine or Consulting a Cultist, which are just Ken wastes everyone's time with nonsense. And Ken's Time Machine is I go back in time and I fix something or change history. And Consulting a Cultist is Robin has run across something in his reading, and he's like, Ken, explain this nonsensical thing to me. And so that's what that is, and that's gaming related, in that time travel and alternate histories are gaming related and occultism is gaming related, but it's really not. It's just me rabbiting on like a goofball. And then we have other segments that just depend on what kind of mood Robin is in when he writes the script that week. So it might be the food hut, or it might be the cinema hut, it might be the Ask Ken and Robin is very popular. People write in, they put on the message board on the website. They say, hey, I've got a question, and Robin will pick them out from Olympus, and we'll do an Ask Ken and Robin segment, and that covers a lot of the ground that we can't put whole huts into. Sometimes we have a politics hut if there's an election going on, or Rob Ford is being hilarious as he used to be in Toronto. Sometimes we just have one-off huts where we talk about something that is in the news or is appealing to both of us at the time. How to write good is one of the things that we do, that sort of focused advice for writers, because we're both writers as well as gamers and game designers.
Sure.
And so there's, and also we're both very Catholic readers. All right, we read a lot of different kinds of stuff that isn't just, you know, game books and game materials or even genre fiction. And so there's a degree of maybe helping people go a little bit outside their comfort zone if they're thinking, well, I like science fiction, but I don't know about mysteries, or I like mysteries, but I don't know about historicals, or I like historical, but I don't know about drama and literature. And so we sort of, you know, play around with that, with how to write good. And we have a thing called Recommendation Engine, where we just talk about things we like that we didn't want to build a whole hut around. So it sort of just Robin and I, you know, back and forthing. But we try and keep at least half the program somewhat useful and focused, and the other half is just me rabbiting on like a goof. So that seems to be a pretty good combo so far. People seem to like it. The 150th episode, which will drop on Friday, I don't know when this is dropping, but it either has dropped or will drop shortly, is our 150th episode, so it's our third year anniversary episode.
Oh, wonderful.
And it will be all lightning round episode, which turns out to be really fun to do because we can answer the questions briefly and move on, as opposed to trying to, you know, wring 15 minutes of juice out of one lemon, which sometimes it's a little harder than others. You know, Robin will ask me about some historical event. It's like, nope, that's what happened. Can't fix it. It's just the way the cake was baked. Well, we have 9 more minutes, Ken, so you'd better come up with something.
Oh, no, that's really cool.
Yeah, but I mean, that's basically what it is. So if you've enjoyed listening to me yammer on this podcast, and God forbid, just go back and you can hear 150 more hours of me doing it, only with Robin. So that'll be a little bonus for you.
No, that's wonderful. Cool.
I mean, someone listened to you on the drive to Gen Con.
Yes. Oh, there was... We get a guy, I don't forget what year that was. It was maybe last year, who shows up and he's there and he's got his son. His son is like 12 or 13, you know, so just that perfect age to start being a gamer, a really hardcore gamer that we love. And he's like, my boy and I listened to your podcast for the whole 8-hour drive to Gen Con. And I was like, oh, that poor kid. There's no way he enjoyed that. It was purely, well, I like my dad more than I like jumping out of the car while it's moving, so I guess I'll stay. But it was just awful. I could just see the pain in his eyes. We do get people who listen to it on their commute or whatever, and, you know, I find that when I'm talking in my normal register, people will say, are you Ken Hite? Because now they recognize my voice, which is deeply strange. Like a little bit of what Hank Azaria must get, I guess.
Well, especially, you know, as a game designer, you're kind of more behind the scenes and setting things up for other people to tell stories and mm-hmm. use their voices. So I guess that's got to be quite a shifting gears.
Well, it is and it isn't. I mean, all creative people are egotists, and any creative person who says he isn't is a bad liar. No one gets into it. No one produces art. No one produces anything to be anonymous about it, right? No one, even the guy who builds your IKEA table is like, I built that IKEA table. And if you say, that's an IKEA table, he'll be like, yeah, I built it. And I just put my name on the IKEA tables that I build. Any sort of signed production is something that you are fond of and you want people to like and enjoy. So it's the thing about writing in general, and game writing in particular, is it is a kind of an anonymous thing to do, and you're solitary, you're in your little cubicle writing all day, and I get feedback from my cat, mostly of the form, why aren't you feeding me, and from my wife, which generally comes in one or the other of that same tenor. But when the larger audience responds, it's always really, really gratifying. And so finding a new way to attract that sort of attention is actually just more fun. It's not a kind of a different fun. It's just weirder because I'm not used to people recognizing my voice yet, I guess.
Yeah.
It's just a strange thing to have. It happened I was at a play in Chicago a couple of weeks ago, and a guy said, are you Ken Hite? It's like, yes, I am. Fortunately, he was very nice and complimentary about it. He wasn't like, you're wrong about the Battle of Poltava. So that's never happened. But,
well,
but he was like, cool. Oh, that's why I'm at this play. It's because you talk about Wildclaw. And so I came to their theater. It's like, yay, the system works.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
All right. I think we're going to end the interview, and I think we're going to wrap things up here. So... Because I'm looking at the time, and I think we're running a bit long here, so I apologize for that, Ken.
It seems to happen on a lot of podcasts that I go on. I don't know what it is. more time management on their part, I suspect.
Well, I'll shoulder the blame on that. Yeah, it's hard to end a good conversation. So, I think we are going to endeavor to do that though. Hello, my name is. It's something that we do on galacticnetcast.com. Find the Adventure Party page, and it's an opportunity for you, the listener, to highlight a character that you've enjoyed playing. You know, maybe you've played something from Chaosium. Maybe you played something from Pathfinder and you have a character that you're really, really proud of. Or Gumshoe, for that matter.
Perhaps.
And you want to tell us about it, we'd love to talk about it. If you go to galacticnetcasts.com and click to the Adventure Party page, we have a link there for Hello, My Name Is, and we have a short form for you to fill out, basically just your name, about your character, a little bit about yourself. And yes, we do ask for an email address. No, we do not spam people. We have no interest in starting a newsletter and having you buy our thing, because we don't have a thing for you to buy. The only reason why we ask for your email address is if we use your information, your character, if we talk about that character, we'll email you a certificate that you can frame or maybe put at the bottom of your bird cage if you so desire. But we'll email that to you, and basically it just says, hey, we talked about your character, and we really appreciate you taking the time to send that to us so that we could talk about it. So we did get some feedback that I wanted to talk about. Our show, we record it through Google Hangouts, which it first is seen by folks visually, and then we convert it to an audio podcast. And we had a viewer on YouTube comment on a couple of our episodes, episode 8 with Andy Gilley, this particular, and I didn't write down the name of the person, and I should be beaten for that. It was such a great and unusual name, and I could have swore I pasted it in. Oh, there we go. Mehoshika Farood is the name of the user on YouTube. And he commented on episode 8, while I haven't ever played any tabletop RPGs, I enjoy watching your conversations, subscribed. And on episode 9, went on to say, that was the episode where we talked about our favorite card and board games and RPGs that that Glenn and I enjoyed playing. I recommend that when you're mentioning how something looks, that you put an image of it. And you're absolutely right. That's my bad. I'm running the show as I'm talking, and sometimes I forget to post images so people who are checking things out on YouTube get a chance to see what we're actually talking about. So I do apologize for that. To make up
you
for
should.
That,
I mean, I'm tired of carrying all the weight here. I mean, all you do is organize this, come up with the questions, edit it, post it.
No. It's one of those things where to make up for that shortcoming, if I do miss that, we do have show notes that accompany. I try to go back and put them into the YouTube. If not, definitely on the audio version, we have full show notes of what happened in the episode and links for you to click so you can see the things that we're talking about if we do forget to put them on YouTube. So I do apologize for that, but there is a way to take a look at that if you didn't get to, if I forgot to post that on YouTube for you to see. So great point, and we will endeavor to do a better job of that in the future. So thank you very much for that feedback. I really appreciate that. Going to wrap things up here. I want to thank Kenneth Hite for taking the time to talk to us. I really appreciate that. We had a great discussion with you and talking about RPGs and the podcast that you do too, and great insight into RPGs. So I really appreciate that. Where could people go? Where would you recommend people go to find out more about you and your work so that they can experience it?
Well, this is the part where Will Hindmarch tears out his hair, because he has held my hand so very, very nicely and tried to get me to set my website up, and it's still sort of living in its nascent universe and is not out. So for now, go on Facebook and friend me or whatever it is you do on Facebook, and on Twitter, follow me, and I'm relatively omnipresent, or at least I'm relatively consistently present on both. And if I've got a project coming out, oh, believe me, I will plug it there. also, of course, listen to the podcast. Robin and I have a segment called Among Our Many Hats, which is a blatant self-promotion as opposed to the concealed self-promotion of the rest of the podcast. So you can pick up on some of the stuff that we're doing by listening to the podcast as well. But yeah, follow. I'm at Kenneth Hite on Twitter, and I'm just good old Kenneth Hite on Facebook. So go right ahead and friend and follow, and you will know at least as much about my life as I do, possibly more.
Fair enough. Glenn, I want to thank you for once again joining me on this ride and talking about games and gaming, things that we love so much. Where can people go to find out more about you or Mistrunner?
You can just follow me on Twitter at Naked Hobo. You can find me on the YouTubes with my movies at Naked Hobo Productions and the B-Movie Bunker. And you can just find me on Facebook, B-Movie Bunker and Mistrunner RPG.
Nice. All right. You can find Adventure Party by going to galacticnetcast.com. That is our home. You can go there to find out more about the social media outlets that we're a part of. I mentioned earlier that we record this and it shows up on YouTube. That's where you get to see the unedited version after we do the show. we try not to get too wild on YouTube. And when we do the audio version, we cut out some of the pauses, some of the extra ums. We just try to make a more polished version of the audio product based off of the video version. We are a little bit behind. I am working. I've actually got somebody helping me to try to help fix how far behind we are. We're about 5 episodes behind as of this point. We'll be 6. And we are doing an episode tomorrow with Benjamin Loomis of Cinescape Productions, Sirenscape Productions. And that's going to be really kind of an interesting thing, talking about music and gaming. And so we are endeavoring to get things caught back up, should have things back hopefully within the next week here. We should have things caught up again. But you can check us out on iTunes and Stitcher. If you do, please take a moment to give us a review. Negative, positive, either way, it can help shape the show. Let us know what you guys are interested on us maybe focusing more on or trimming out, because it's not quite as interesting as perhaps Glenn and I think it is. Your feedback can really help make a better show, and I'm not going to ask you to give us a 5-star review. You review what you think that is...
would it kill you? I mean, really? Give a 5-star review. Come on.
A 5-star review would be awesome.
Yeah. Get the real Enterprise on the wall behind him. You gotta respect.
Oh, it's even better because.
Oh, yeah. Look at that!
It has
light up photon torpedoes.
Yep.
That's pretty boss. That's 5 stars right there.
See, boom. Say. Yeah. And a glowing review from Kenneth Hite. Yes. How could I possibly lose there? So just let us know what you think. We'd really appreciate that. We enjoy engaging with you guys and letting you know how much we appreciate you taking the time out of your day or evening to listen to us and having us join your day. So you can leave us feedback by emailing galacticnetcasts@gmail.com. We also have a number that you can contact us at, either by leaving us a voice message, or you can text us at this number. That number is 805-328-3966. Again, 805-328-3966. And you can leave us a voice message, or you can text us. You can also go to galacticnetcasts.com, and we use WordPress for our site, and we have a really cool plugin where if you click it, and the link to it is this red box that's off to the right-hand side. If you have a microphone attached to your computer, you can actually leave a voice message directly on your computer, and then it just emails to us, and we can get your feedback all instant-like, as the interwebs is so good at doing. So thank you very much for joining us on the Adventure Party. May your characters never die, and your adventures always be epic. Good night.
Trying to win base cards by playing more hits. on your side of the table and playing blocks to stop hits from your opponent. And when I say it's super quick, I'm talking a game takes under 2 minutes.
It's a no fooling around game.
No fooling around. So,
and if you get a chance to, if you've seen in our show notes, you can click in there and you can see the listing for Brawl and watch the video. Watching the two gentlemen play the game. The two gentlemen play the game, and it's moving. So it's something where you need to pay attention to detail, and if you don't, you're gonna lose. So
you only have 5 days left.
Yeah, and for the cost of what it takes to get in, $21 gets you two different Brawl decks, which is the minimum that you need to play. So $21 to get in on a game, that's next to nothing. That's really cool. And if you jump in at, what is it? You can get all six decks.
At 51.
At $51. And combined between, they had a $52, which was the early bird. There's, 428 backers at that level. To get all six games. So people were really hot to get this game again. Because this is a re-release, we talked about this. This is a re-release of the cheap ass game. And yep. I'm trying to think of, I had a question and now it's gone. Was it the same structure as? I mean, this is just a re-release. There's no updates. It's just a re-release of the game. Correct?
Just a re-release, as far as I have been able to ascertain so far. I probably, if it's like most of releases, they probably updated the artwork.
Sure. Yep.
But that's about it. It's pretty much the same game.
Okay. And they passed it by, which is very good news. And you know, for a name like Cheap Ass, who has established themselves with making wonderful games at a low cost, you know it's going to be good. And because it's a re-release, you know that this has been thoroughly tested and appreciated and well loved. So it's great to see that they surpassed their goal, and this is definitely going to happen. And it will be released, the estimated delivery, is January of 2016. So right around the corner here in the grand scheme of things. All right. Well, we're going to talk about our spotlight, our new spotlight, which is called The Voting Game, which is... It's a party game, so we've got a little bit of a theme going there. It's billed as a game where you find out who your friends really are. To me, it kind of reminded me a little bit of, at least in the packaging structure, of Cards Against Humanity. It's a kind of a simple black box, but inside of it are questions that you ask the group. It can play up to 10 players, which I thought was... let me just double check that.
It says plays up to 10, but I love the asterisk of the, who are you kidding? You don't have 10 friends.
Yes. Now, the box comes with questions, and it comes with numbers. So what ends up happening is the question card is flipped over, and it asks a question such as... who would survive the longest zombie apocalypse? And then everybody, face down, puts down the player number. So everybody is given a number. And then everybody puts down their number card as to who they think would, in this particular case, survive the longest in a zombie apocalypse. And then it's scored by how many times you particularly win each question. It's really, really kind of a neat concept. And they've already got expansions. They have a NSFW expansion. There is a fill-in-the-blank expansion. And there is a create-your-own, which is 80 blank cards that you can make up to 80 more questions Maybe it's more inside jokes for your group or things like that. It puts the control in your hands to expand the game, which is really kind of a neat concept. $25 gets you in at the ground floor to get the original, the core game of voting. And $50 gets you all three expansions, which is really kind of cool. And if you decide to go big, you can spend $90 and get two copies of the core game and two copies of each of the three expansions, which is really kind of cool. Looking at this right now, their goal is $7,500. And with 30 days to go, they're at $4,500. So they are more than halfway there. So this looks like something that's going to absolutely happen. So based on what I've seen here, it looks like this would be a very, very fun game. Doesn't take too long to play. And it's kind of like, and I know you don't like Cards Against Humanity, Glenn. and I don't know, Kenneth, if you had an opportunity. Hello, and welcome to the 16th gathering of the Adventure Party on this, the 18th of July. I am your party leader, Brad Ludwig. We ask that you peace tie your swords, holster your blasters, and make sure you know the difference between a shuggoth and a deep one while you're gathered at the meeting table. As always, the second in command here at the Adventure Party is Glenn Bittner. He is a movie reviewer on the YouTube show The B-Movie Bunker and is the creator of the RPG Mistrunner. How are you this fine evening, sir?
I am quite well, Brad. Thank you for asking.
you sound like you took a tranquilizer before the show, sir. You all right?
Oh, just fine. Just
winding down from a long day, I bet.
Winding down. I'd leave here and go paint some happy trees.
There you go. Or some miniatures at least.
Yes.
our guest today is game designer Kenneth Hite of Pelgrane Press. The Pelgrane Press publishes a number of RPGs, which include Owlhoot Trail, which I have played and enjoy the heck out of, 13th Age, Gumshoe, and much, much more. Kenneth has worked on created the game settings in Gumshoe for Trail of Cthulhu and Night's Black Agents. You know, the more I... In the course of getting things ready for a show, I went down the rabbit hole and I looked at all this stuff that you are a part of, sir, and it's fantastic, and I can't wait to talk to you about some of that. Kenneth has been working in the game industry for quite some time, working with games and game settings such as Star Trek, GURPS, and RuneQuest. He is also the author of the Cthulhu Mythos-style books called Mini Mythos, with titles such as Where the Deep Ones Are, Antarctic Express, and Clifford the Big Red God. And I have to tell you, I put them in my Amazon wish list as soon as I found them.
And add Good Night Azbathoth to that wish list, because that will be out this summer.
Oh, wonderful.
Yes.
Okay, well, that's definitely going on the list. He, too, is also a podcaster, along with his co-host Robin Laws, of the podcast called Ken and Robin Talk About Stuff. Welcome, sir, to the Adventure Party.
Thanks for bringing me in and letting me join you for this expedition through our metaphorical dungeon of podcasting.
Really appreciate it. We are going to, as we do in every show, we're going to roundtable the different sections of our show, which include the game review, gaming news, and an interview with our guest. We're going to kick that off now with Glenn Bittner's review of an interesting game from North Star Games. Please, tell us a bit about that.
This game is called Evolution, and it's kind of a resource, in a way, kind of a resource management type game, where each player, you have to adapt your species. You basically start with a couple of different species, and you're adapting them to the ecosystem. You want to make them bigger, stronger, higher in numbers, stuff like that. But in order to do that, you have to keep them safe, and you also have to keep them fed. the gameplay is really interesting, where you draw cards, depending on how many species you have, and then the first thing you're going to do is you're going to take one of those cards and you're going to play it face down into a communal pot, basically. Because every card that is... all the cards are upgrades that you can give your species, but every card also has a number value to it, which will be used to determine how much food is at the watering hole each turn. And any creature that is not a carnivore has to get their food from the watering hole. Now, then take the rest of your cards, and you can do things such as play them face up to give your species different advantages. You might give yourself a long neck, meaning you can get more food. You might give yourself like a hard shell to protect yourself from carnivores, or you may even upgrade yourself to a carnivore, where now, instead of eating from the watering hole, you eat other player species. Which happens to me too often in this game. but you have to manage everything, because you can also make your creatures bigger. Because if you're bigger, carnivores can't eat you as easily, because a carnivore will eat something smaller than it. You have to make sure you have more numbers, because the more numbers you have, the less likely you are to go extinct.
Sure.
Because if you hit zero on the number track, your species goes extinct. You can also add more species if you want. So it's all managing all these different things, because the food, at the beginning of the game, there's going to be more food than anyone can eat.
Okay.
And food is actually how you score points. Because every time you eat, you place your food in this little bag. At the end of the game, you total up how many food you have in your bag, and that's whoever is the most is going to win. Plus, you get bonuses for the population of your species and then different traits as well. But food's where you're going to score the most of your points. It's a hoot. I like this game a lot. And I was really surprised when I first heard that North Star Games made it, because up until this point, North Star Games did party games. Their most well-known game is Wits and Wagers, which is basically a trivia, kind of betting trivia game. And when this one came out, I actually had one of the guys who works for North Star came to our store and demoed it. He's actually friends of one of my coworkers. And when I mentioned my surprise of them making it, he goes, yeah. He goes, this is the kind of game that everyone who works at North Star Games plays and wants to make, but they made the party game first because they knew that it would sell, and will then let them have the ability to make a game like Evolution. So
okay, sure.
Huh. But it plays pretty quickly once you understand the rules. Average play time is about an hour. It's 2 to 6 players. It's can be very competitive, although you do at times get a bit of cooperation amongst people where the carnivores will divvy up who they're going to eat. although carnivores can eat each other. And one trick, too, is if they're...
opportunity to play cards against humanity.
Oh, yeah, I've played it.
And it's a game where really nobody wins. You all lose a piece of your soul. It's kind of a neat approach to doing a party game like that that can include a lot of people and be entertaining. Would you, based on that short... overview that I gave it, does that sound like something that you guys would play if you were at a party?
Well, I mean, if I'm at a party, I'm there to socialize. So if everyone else is playing, their Cards Against Humanity or that or Werewolf or whatever, you do it because that's why you're there, right? That's just politeness. Would I break it out and say, "Hey guys, let's do this instead of drink and have fun"? No, of course not. But one is not always in charge. That's what I've found out in this life.
That is very true. That is very true. Glenn, what say you?
If people wanted to play it, I would play it with them, but this is... I would probably enjoy this more than Cards Against Humanity because there's at least a little bit of room for creativity, which is my biggest complaint with Cards Against Humanity is that there's no... it's just simply, oh, okay, I will play Auschwitz because that's offensive. There, I'm done. And this, you might have to put a little more thought into it. And I can see there actually being more discussion after the answers are revealed with the person who's like, why do you think she would last in the zombie apocalypse? She'd be the first one to die. You are all idiots.
Yeah, that
could be. As opposed to someone just going and crying, because they actually know a child with ass cancer, and that's not really that funny.
Yeah, I'd give you that. I'd give you that. I could see that making or breaking, the voting game, making or breaking some friendships, for sure. And it's going to be an interesting, we all have our own personal view as to, you know, what we can and can't do and what we're all about, and to get that chance to see yourself through somebody else's eyes could be a wonderful experience, or leave you curled up in a ball crying in a corner of the room. So, yeah.
Well, right now everyone, not everyone, but a lot of people are trying to be the next Cards Against Humanity. They want to be the game that everyone wants to play and everyone wants to own, and they can sell, you know. And they want to be the guys who can say, hey, you know what? We're going to sell poop in a box, and people are going to buy it, and people will buy it, and we'll sell out. These people, they want to be that next, you know, that next person who can do that.
Yeah, and cards.
Minimal effort, maximum reward.
Yeah, yeah. That's the American dream, isn't it?
I think it's a lot of people's dreams, actually. I mean, there you have people who really do work hard, but a lot of people, if it's the, hey, if you could put in 5 hours of work and get $1 million, would you do it? Most people are going to say, yeah, I'll go.
Well, I don't know, 5 hours, that's a lot. I mean, like all at once, or just spaced out over a week? What are we talking about?
I mean, maybe a week.
Yeah, all right, maybe. We'll talk. Just send me those prospectus, and we'll get on that.
And that's the thing too, is you have, they want to be that, because some people are people who haven't worked in the game design field at all. Just think that, you know, oh, I make a game and I'll just make $1 million. No, that's not most game designers.
Well, I mean, Cards Against Humanity sort of managed to, you know, strike while the iron was hot. It had a really great graphic look, which is, I think, a big part of it. And it managed to ride that sort of viral wave really, really well. So, you know, regardless of its merits or demerits as a thing you do with friends, allegedly, you have to look at the way that they handled the actual marketing, production, all the professional...
They did marketing great.
All the professional hard part, you know, to me, of game design, the part where you get your game out in front of people's eyeballs, make people talk about it, that's something that, you know, when it happened, it wasn't just a flash in the pan. They're still, you know, cranking along. I mean, Max and the guys are in Chicago, so I've met them, and I've got friends who are, like, you know, in business relationships with them. So it's, you know, they're still, you know, moving along, and they're trying to move from strength to strength. But there's plenty of people that I know that who have been handled, or who have been handed massive success and managed to piss that away because they had no idea what to do with it. And that, I think, is the real difference, right, as to who's going to stick around. It's not entirely your game design chops, although it helps that Cards Against Humanity isn't obviously broken, possibly because there's barely a mechanic to it, as you alluded to earlier. But but the ability to present it, sell it, market it, expand on it and reinforce it, those are things that are not easy to do either. And so they deserve all the credit for that and for, you know, trying to stay in the field and, you know, come back to it. So, you know, it's not an either or, but just like after Magic came out, like you said, you know, everyone wanted to be the next Magic cards. I mean, you know, you got, you know, 150 cards with crappy art on them and surely people will trade them. That didn't happen either. And so I think a lot of people are looking at that sort of adult party game space that Cards Against Humanity pioneered or re-pioneered, because it had been around a lot before in other games, but pioneered for this century at least. And they're saying, well, can we get into that? Is that space, like Magic turned out to be, a space that's big enough for other huge successes? Or is it going to be something where, no, there's just one game and a bunch of little sort of orbiting wastes of everyone's valuable time? But you'd feel like an idiot if you had the next Yu-Gi-Oh! Or Pokemon and you were like, nope, I'm pretty sure that category's full. We're never going to make another, you know, after Magic, no more card games, no more CGs, right? So, you know, I think it just makes sense to give it a shot and see what happens. And again, I think
it's a shame it got a bad rap. It was a lot of fun. But going back to Edgar Rice Burroughs, it's kind of cool to see a company that already has the Conan property, and I don't know if you gentlemen have had an opportunity to partake of the Conan RPG, but it's to me, it's very comforting to know that a company that has done Edgar Rice Burroughs right is going to be picking up this property as well and adapting
Conan it. Conan is not Edgar Rice Burroughs, though. Conan is Robert E. Howard.
Oh! Oh, my God! Yes, you're... Oh.
Brad.
I know. Now I feel terrible.
I mean, it's still sword fights and brunettes, so, I mean, you're half right. But,
see, now, look at, see, now I'm embarrassed. All right. But, in my defense, their styles are not dissimilar. I'm trying to redeem myself
here. They're both dead.
Well, there's that, too. Well, to me, the adaptation of Conan is so solid. You know, magic is not as wondrous as D&D magic. It does stay true to Howard's vision. So it's kind of cool to see them getting the chance to do something like that with this property.
Yeah, I mean, Modiphius has generally done a pretty good job with their various licensed properties all the way across the board. So I assume as long as whoever the sort of lead designer or whatever has got a genuine love and understanding of the Barsoom novels, I think it'll probably be, you know, just as successful as the other Modiphius stuff has been in terms of recapturing that original spark.
Sure.
Do you know who the designer is, or just the company?
Yeah, I just know the company, but let me check. I do have a link from the company, from Modiphius, and I want to see if they mention... No, they don't. They don't seem to have a, or they're not mentioning if they have a designer assigned to it and who it is.
If it's coming out in Christmas, the designer is already, you know.
Well, yeah, no, absolutely. That's not something you put together in a month.
Pretty much done with it, actually.
I should say, obviously. Yeah, it should be at the editing and printing phase at this point if they're going to get it out. You're absolutely right.
Or at the very least in the, you know, art and everything else phase.
Sure.
Yeah, no, I'm sure that they've got someone, and then they just didn't put it in the press release for some reason. You know, foolish economy of space, perhaps. Anyway, perhaps. But the larger point is that they've done a good job on their other licensed properties, so this would be one of those that if you're interested in John Carter, give it a look and see if it appeals to you, right?
Yeah, no, absolutely.
And again, planetary romance and sword and sorcery are not so far apart that you can't make some judgment based on how well they did Conan, because at least it means they're not just simply porting the same thing back and forth. They're paying some attention to the nature of the world. So yeah.
Gosh, you'd hope so. if it's gonna be successful, absolutely. Glenn, have you ever had a chance to check out the Conan RPG?
I have not checked out a Conan RPG since the 80s.
Oh, fair enough.
Like three but Conan RPGs ago.
I have looked a bit at something else from Modiphius, which is the Octum Cthulhu. So World War II type Cthulhu stuff with Nazis and all that. So,
oh.
One of the people at work has picked up everything available for it and is planning on running a campaign.
Nice. Of course,
at a game store, we're always planning on running campaigns that we never do.
True enough. That kind of sounds like that would be in your wheelhouse, Kenneth, the Octum Cthulhu.
Yeah, Sarah Newton, I guess, is sort of doing a lot of the writing for that. She's a good friend and a fine designer and researcher. And I wrote a little tiny bit in the Keeper's Guide for Octum Cthulhu because Chris Birch wanted me to explain why you don't blame the Nazis on the Cthulhu mythos and how to handle the sort of presence of two very different kinds of evil in your horror role-playing game. And I did it like two pages out of 180, so I just barely am in the book at all. But Chris liked it, and I thought that it was the sort of thing that's important to say, because otherwise you end up saying, oh, well, it's not the Nazis' fault. It was Nyarlathotep that did that. And it's like, no, it kind of was the Nazis' fault. They were horrible, horrible people, and you can't let them off the hook just by blaming, you know, Haster or somebody.
True enough.
Yeah.
Okay. Very cool. Well, we are going to extend our news here a little bit further. We're going to have Ryan Murphy take over. He is the contributor to Galactic Netcasts, who offers us the Galactic Gaming News, and he covers more of the digital beat of gaming, and he has a brand new update for us. So take it away, Ryan. All right. Thanks for that report, Ryan. Appreciate it. Next up, we're going to get into the Kickstarter Spotlight. And we are going to recap last week's pick, which was Brawl, which was an updated cheap-ass card game. And Glenn, that was your pick, so give us a little bit of insight on that.
So when we looked at it last week, they still had a bit to go to their goal of 30,000. They have now passed their goal. They're at 35,361. They got 5 days left.
Nice.
Just quick recap, Brawl is a super-fast two-player fighting game where you have isn't anything for a carnivore to eat. You might be eating your own species, because if you have two species and your carnivore can't eat anyone else except your own other guy, he'll eat your other guy. So you have to be careful, because you might end up eating yourself into extinction. It's a really nifty game. It's got beautiful art on the cards too. Sorry about that. It's a really fun game from a company that I wasn't expecting it from.
Huh.
How does it compare to Urzupa, the other, sort of the big amoeba in the evolutionary games world?
You know, I have not played that one.
Oh.
So.
Well, I haven't played this one, so we're two halves of the locket, and we haven't been joined.
And actually, I had someone ask me that exact question yesterday, and I just haven't been able to look that one up yet, because it's been pretty hectic at work the last day and a half.
Yeah, well, no doubt.
All right. So, highly competitive, would you say, in that hour?
It starts off, everyone's all friendly and nice, because everyone starts off as just an herbivore. You all eat the plants that are growing at the watering hole. But as soon as someone plays carnivore, all bets are off. Plus the fact that then the carnivore, they're gonna contribute as little food as possible to the watering hole, because they want everyone else to stay small and weak so they can just keep eating them. So aside from having to run away from carnivores, you're also then competing for food like mad. So you want to get upgrades that let you get, like long neck lets you take extra food. And there's some things, there's like scavenger, which if the carnivore kills someone and eats them, you need to take an extra food out of the watering hole because you're scavenging the remains. So competition for food becomes very fierce, even amongst the herbivores, because the food supply dwindles. The bigger species get, the more they need to eat.
Sure. Oh, okay. Wow, that sounds like a really... It doesn't sound like a beer and pretzels kind of a game. Or would you classify it as really...
More of a twigs and steaks.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I think it's casual enough, because, I mean, it depends how many people are playing. It can get kind of crazy. I played it with six, and that gets crazy because it's a lot of people to keep track of with their species. Most people will be running one to three species. So even if everyone's only running one, now you got to keep track of six different species, plus all their upgrades, then most people are going to have two, so now you're talking 12 species with all their upgrades. So now it's like, okay, so you've got the guy who is size 4, but because of this upgrade, he hunts at a size 6, so I got to make sure my guy's bigger than a size 6 to not get eaten by you. But if I'm too big, this guy over here has all these upgrades to let him take extra food, so I won't be able to feed my guy, so he's going to die anyways. So maybe I'll focus on my other person over here. So there's a lot to keep track of. So if you have too many beers, I think you're going to miss out on everything that's going on.
So it's a survivalist resource management game.
Yes.
Okay. Very interesting. All right. Well, thank you for that, sir. We're going to jump into the news here. Modiphius to create games based on John Carter series of books. Modiphius is going to be making a couple of new games based on John Carter, which was written by Edgar Rice Burroughs. Modiphius has announced two games based on the material, an RPG and a board game. and they will be releasing some collectible miniatures for the RPG as well. John Carter, the role-playing game, is set for a Christmas 2015 release, so just a few months away here. It will use the 2D20 light system, also used in Mutant Chronicles Infinity and the Conan RPGs. Characters will be able to explore Barsoom, which is the Martian name for Mars, as we call it on Earth, from its deserts to its ancient cities. There will be stats for all the major characters from the books. And to help augment the RPG, there will be the miniatures that I mentioned before, which are being released spring of 2016. Now, also being released that spring of 2016 is John Carter, Warlord of Mars, which is a board game that will allow the players to save Barsoom from all the all evils, from scientists to ancient forces to other things. I like how they sinisterly put the dot, 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 other things. This article was from Tabletop Gaming News. Now, I've had the opportunity to play the Conan RPG, which was a lot of fun and very true to the feel of the books. And who here saw the John Carter of Mars movie?
Do I really have to admit that?
You don't have to if you don't want to. That's all right. Kenneth?
Happily, I saw the trailer first, and so it was like, well, if you don't want me to see the movie, then I certainly don't want to see the movie. I mean, that just seems fair, right, Disney? I mean, why would I question them? They edited the trailer, right?
You know, and their whole marketing strategy, originally it was The Princess of Mars, and then they changed gears and changed the title, and that was, at that point,
they figured that boys wouldn't want to see something called Princess of Mars, so they changed it, and then no one saw it.
Oh, it's a wonderful film, and directed by okay, now we're turning into a movie review podcast, and I apologize for that, but Andrew Stanton is the guy who created Finding Nemo, and he was the director of this film.